Alrighty, brothers and friends, I'm Alec Deer, the Director of Development here at the AEPi Foundation. I want to welcome and thank you for attending today's AEPiConnect 11 Leadership Speaker Series with Josh Rawitch, Indiana Class of 1998, or as many of you may know him, the new president of the National Baseball Hall of Fame. Alpha Epsilon Pi is a Jewish leadership organization on campus and the premier Jewish fraternity around the world. When opportunities like this speaker series arise, we not only like to hear from our alumni, but we also like to showcase our undergraduates on campus who continue to amaze us. Interviewing Brother Rawitch today is Sammy Sommerfeld, a senior journalism major and sports enthusiast out of the University of Iowa. Josh and Sammy, thank you so much for being with us today. I'm positive our guests will truly enjoy this webinar. Sammy, the Zoom is yours.
Thanks, Alec. Hi, Josh. So my first question for you is, why did you choose AEPi and what are some of your favorite memories and most memorable experiences as a brother?
First of all, just a thank you to everybody for taking time out of your day to hang out here for a little bit. Looking forward to catching up with everybody. And honestly, to answer your question, it really was when I got to Indiana, I came from California, born and raised in Los Angeles. I had not even really thought about the Greek system being something I'd get involved in. And my first semester freshman year, I didn't. And at IU, I'd say there's just such a large percentage of the population that does get involved with the Greek system from if you come from out of state. So kind of one semester in, I looked around and I thought, you know, I gotta take a look, see what these fraternities are all about. And really, I just remember there were about three or four of us who wound up kind of going to dinner with a couple of random, I guess, mostly junior and senior brothers who were probably at the time involved in whether Rush or whatever it was, leadership in the house. And you just, you know, you get a feel for what that type of person is like. And if that's the type of person that's in the house, that it would be a place I'd want to be a part of. So that was how I wound up picking AEPi. I mean, there were 40 something fraternities at IU, so no shortage of them. But in terms of my best memories, it's a lot of them honestly have to do with probably living in the house. I mean, last night I was basically there's probably six or seven guys from the house that I'm still in touch with pretty regularly. And I shot them all a note last night, told them what I was doing today. And it led to, I don't even know, a 40 minute text chain of hilarity of just the ridiculous things that you do when you're in college, from the washing of the dishes to pledgeship to Little 500, which I don't know if we have any Indiana people here, but Little 500 is just an incredible week. That's probably the most fun week that IU has. And I look back and I really kind of appreciate more than anything, honestly, meeting my wife. That was really the biggest thing that I remember from AEPi was meeting my wife my junior year inside our fraternity house right before a party started. And so that was really, I'd say, the single best thing that being a part of this fraternity has brought me is literally everything else in my life and my family.
That's great. So talking on Indiana University, during your college career, what drew you to wanting to pursue a career in the sports industry and kind of gearing and navigating towards a path, you know, in sports? And what were kind of steps you took to get your early professional opportunities out of school?
Well, when I went to, I mean, I knew that I loved baseball from being a kid, probably from 5 years old. I always loved the game. And I don't think I really knew that there was a thing so that you could work in the offices. You knew about a general manager, but in 1995, it wasn't anything quite the way it was now. So I went to college thinking I might want to be a sports broadcaster. I always thought maybe I'd be the next Vin Scully. But as you all can hear, my voice is not quite his. And very quickly, my freshman year, I had a professor within the first like month say, hey, you know, don't be afraid to send your resume to your hometown team. You never know what'll happen. And I didn't even have a resume at the time. I really didn't have much to put on it, but I worked with an advisor, put something together and fired it off and just somehow luckily landed an internship at the Dodgers, which is clearly not the sort of thing that would happen in this day and age with the competitive nature of the industry. But I got lucky to kind of land that first internship, which was all unpaid. And within, I don't even know, 48 hours of walking in the building, I was very clear in my mind that this is what I wanted to do. I just absolutely loved being at the ballpark. I loved being around the game. And so I wound up ultimately interning for another couple summers. Every year I would come back from IU. I'd intern again for a little while. And then I was lucky enough to land a full-time job pretty much right out of the final 3 weeks of college. Somebody left in the department I was in, and I called and said, hey, could I interview for the job? And he said, how quickly can you start? And I said, I graduate on a Friday. I can drive across country, be there on Monday. And so, I mean, so much of life, as we know, is luck and good fortune being in the right place at the right time. But the sports industry for me, it was really about getting in that very first internship and then also working in the athletic department at IU and kind of honing my skills that way.
So joining the Dodgers in the mid to late 90s and then working for two organizations in your career with the Dodgers and the Diamondbacks, in your position working with media in the MLB, have you seen print and the digital media kind of change over time during your career?
Honestly, it's really completely different than it was when I started. I mean, I think about being at IU in the mid 90s and websites were just starting out. Every once in a while, I'd go on Dodgers.com and try to figure out what was happening back in Los Angeles. And they were just very basic kind of, I mean, incredible for the time, but very basic websites. And then you just think about when I first started in the PR department, we were sending faxes, we were making phone calls, all the things that kind of anybody who would have been in that industry in the 70s, 80s, 90s would have been doing. And really it was probably around, I don't know, maybe 07 or so, whenever Facebook really kind of started to get known, that there was somebody in the office who came into my office one day and said, this thing is kind of crazy. Like, I feel like we ought to start a page for our team. And we did, and you could actually see in real time, you'd post something and you would watch the likes go 100 literally in real time. And it just, that was, I think, the aha moment for me, like, man, we can talk directly to our fans without having to pitch stories and not having to try to convince a journalist to write what we're asking them to write. We can just go direct to the fans. And I mean, I grew up with two journalists as parents, so I have incredible respect for what journalists do. But I also think that it's important for an organization to talk directly to their fans, constituents, customers, et cetera. So, I mean, it's completely different from when I started. And the fact that, I mean, pretty much all day, every day, I'm able to interact with fans on social media, and you can see in real time the impact it's having. It honestly is a totally different industry than the one that I got into 28 years ago.
Have you seen the way social media changed the way baseball fans consume baseball content, whether it's the highlights or, you know, other types of events and experiences?
Yeah, I mean, I really, honestly, I get to watch my son every day, and the way he consumes baseball is just totally different. He's on Twitter, he's on YouTube, he knows everything that's gone on in baseball the day before, but he very rarely sits down and watches nine innings of a baseball game like I did, or listens on the radio. Certainly he isn't listening on the radio at this point, but I think social is basically, it's really allowed people to kind of have it be, some people will say it's worse because they're not sitting here watching the intricacies of every play and learning strategy and really truly getting to know everything about every player. But the reality is with social media, they're on 24/7. So, I mean, it's not just that when I was a kid, you'd sit down for whatever, 2.5 hours on a Saturday, maybe your team was on TV. You'd get to watch a game, and that was kind of what, then you'd open up the paper the next day and have to kind of make the picture happen in your head. They're seeing every highlight nonstop. I mean, you take the amount of time that he's consuming baseball and sports. It's certainly more than I was. So I don't see it as a negative. I just think it's very different. And I think as organizations in charge of, certainly the Hall of Fame in charge of the history of the game, we've got to keep that in mind. We've got to make sure that we're delivering this stuff to people that age, that they're going to continue to love it and love the history of it, so that when they walk in here, they have the same impression of the Hall of Fame that I did 20 years ago when I came for the first time.
So with the Baseball Hall of Fame being a place where you preserve the game of baseball, teach people about the game of baseball, and also exhibit baseball in unique ways, how have you guys used technology and innovation to, show the next generation, you know, teach them about players, or, you know, show them, you know, other parts of the game of baseball?
I mean, from our standpoint, it really, the word content sounds kind of, I don't know, mumbo jumbo, or people kind of focus on this word content, but probably 6-7 years ago, I had the opportunity to kind of move up at the Diamondbacks. When I left the Dodgers, I was at the Diamondbacks for the last decade. And we kind of started treating everything we put out into the world as content, whether it was the graphic designers or the videographers or the stuff you see on the big screen board. And we kind of tied all these things together. And I think that's really probably when you think about just every single thing that we create. If it's a photo taken by our team photographer, we'll think about it in the context of, okay, where can we put this on social media? Can we turn it into a moving graphic that goes somewhere? Can we make a video out of it? And how do we essentially just use the technology that exists to our advantage? And we just had yesterday an interesting meeting. I thought it was interesting. It was basically the strategic plan for the Hall of Fame. I was able to kind of deliver what myself and the rest of the senior staff had put together for 2022. And, you know, one of the things we talked about was needing to incorporate technology into a lot of the things we do. But at the same time, we don't want to be so far ahead in technology that we get in front of the curve and we start spending money on things that don't stick. We kind of have to make sure that if we're going to, we're a nonprofit organization. I don't know that most people realize that, but if we're going to spend our time and energy and resources on something, it can't be something that's kind of going to disappear in a couple of years. And so yesterday I used the example, I'm guessing, I don't see a lot of faces, but by the faces that I do see, I'm guessing not a lot of TikTok users probably on here, but maybe your kids or grandkids are, and that's an area we absolutely have to be. But maybe a year ago, we wanted to make sure that this was still truly the right place to be, because otherwise you end up like, I don't know if you remember 6-7 years ago, everybody was talking about 3D television and we were all gonna start needing 3D TVs. If we'd invested a whole bunch of money in that, we would have really been in trouble. So it's really just about figuring out how to take these really amazing archives we have and the incredible exhibits and bring them to the people, not only here in Cooperstown, but everywhere else in the country and in the world.
So you talk about, you know, content being kind of the king and, you know, growing and promoting the game of baseball, the National Baseball Hall of Fame and franchises. When you were with the Diamondbacks in 2020 during the pandemic shortened season, and fans couldn't go into the stadiums or watch their teams live in person, how did you kind of work on bringing the team to them through content?
Well, certainly social media was a huge part of it. But we also, I think like most organizations, honestly, this right here, what we're doing became pretty commonplace. We started doing a lot of virtual engagements where we would either have players get in or former players. We did a reunion of the 2001 World Series and had people be able to jump. I mean, again, it's really no different than what you're doing right now, which maybe 3 or 4 years ago might've been a conference call. It might've been an in-person conference. It just wasn't a thing that was commonplace. Interestingly, here at the Hall, they've actually been doing these kind of virtual engagements long before COVID. It was part of our education program. So from a Diamondback standpoint, it really was about, okay, how do we keep people engaged? How do we make fun stuff, particularly from when we shut down on March 13 until we started summer camp, they called it, which was basically the second spring training in early July. We had 2 months with nothing really to talk about. And we at one point had our general manager and the quick answer to your question, and it's not really quick, but I guess we look at absolutely everything in our building as something that hopefully a baseball fan finds interesting. So I remember one day our general manager, Mike Hazen, said to me that he and his family were doing the Hazen Olympics, and he's got 4 boys and he was racing them in the backyard and all the things that all of us were trying to do in COVID to try to keep busy. And I said, can we come film it? Can we actually make like the Hazen Olympics something? He goes, yeah, I don't care. So we made a whole content series out of the Hazen Olympics. And we had one woman in the sales department said she had turtles. And we're like, can we put names of our players on the turtles and race them and make a video out of it? She's like, I don't care. So we put Randy and Gonzo and whatever, Matt Williams on the shells of the turtles and tried to see who won. So, I mean, just we were trying to find any way to keep fans engaged until games started. And then once we got to summer camp, it was really about making sure that they felt like they were there, because it was really weird. I was one of maybe, I don't know, 20 of us that were allowed in the stadium. And so you're sitting in an empty stadium and balls are clanging off of seats and it just didn't have the feel. It's when we already knew how important the fans were, but if you ever needed to know, that drove the point home that these games just aren't the same. We're piping in the crowd noise. It's just that the TV sounded better and that the fan, that the players felt like there were fans there. It was pretty, it's pretty strange. It's definitely something I'm going to remember for a long time.
Yeah, that's really interesting. So working for, you know, two baseball organizations and now working at the Hall of Fame, what are kind of some similarities in your role that you kind of have to, you have had to deal with from both aspects, from the organization and the baseball Hall of Fame side of it? And then how do they really differ from each other from the experiences you've had so far?
I'd say the biggest similarity is that we are not all that different in terms of being a business. I mean, people ask me, like, what is your normal day like? And it's like, well, what would the president of any organization do? I mean, everything from finance and HR to marketing and communications to sponsorship and development to operations and making sure that the building is clean and all the things that really any running any business. My job isn't really all that drastically different than, say, the president of the Diamondbacks who hired me over there, Derek Hall. He's doing all of those same things at the Diamondbacks. And so I think I was very fortunate to learn from him. He helped me learn how to lead. He kind of always encouraged me to keep taking on more opportunities and do more and be ready if that opportunity ever came. And so I feel like from a business standpoint, it's really, frankly, anybody who's on the call who has worked in business, owns their own business, all of those same things that I would say are very similar to a team. The other thing that I think is really similar to the team is a passion. There is so much passion for the Hall of Fame. People have such strong opinions about who belongs and who doesn't and why, and how screwed up are you guys that you can't figure out this? And other people who think, like, how screwed up are the people who think you're screwed up? There's just passion everywhere for the brand. And that's very similar to a team where people live it. They're in it every single second of every day and they love it. So the biggest difference, I'd say two of them probably. One is that we're a nonprofit. And so there's all sorts of laws and rules and ways in which you operate that are very different than a typical business, including development. One of my main jobs is going out and trying to find donors who want to help contribute to the mission here, which is really preserving history for eternity. That's a long time. So if we're going to try to keep things safe and able to be visited 100 years from now, that obviously takes money. And so the development piece of it, the nonprofit piece, is probably one of the biggest differences. And then the other one that I think I recognized right away is that there are very few jobs, I think, in the world where you have an outcome every single night. And for 6 months during the baseball season, we either won or we lost. And I had nothing to do with it, but it impacted the office. You came in the next day, and if you're on a 5-game winning streak, everybody's upbeat, everybody's excited, we're in first place. A lot of teams, we used to give ice cream when we were in first place with the Dodgers. There were like actual elements to your day that mattered based on the outcome, quite often that you had nothing to do with. Here, there isn't an outcome every day. It's very different. I leave here 5:30 or so, and I'm home at 5:31. I mean, my commute is 30 seconds to my house. It's very different than Los Angeles or Phoenix, or where I'd get in at 8 o'clock in the morning and be there till 11 o'clock at night when the last player left. And but they're both very special in different ways. And I just feel incredibly lucky that I get to do this for a living.
What are some of the perks and the highlights for you in this position so far, working at the Baseball Hall of Fame?
Well, I mean, this town and this venue is just, it is so special. It's what it, when they first approached me about potentially interviewing for this position, it almost overwhelms you that someone could even think that you might be able to do a job like this. And so even literally, I mean, a perk truly is walking through the doors. I drive on Main Street. I look to my right. I see the Hall of Fame, and I kind of have to pinch myself every day that this is where I get to go to work. But then, I mean, there's no doubt that when I first started working in sports, one of the things that I really loved was kind of the interaction with the players, the actual game on the field. And so certainly when I get a phone call from whoever, Randy Johnson or Sandy Koufax or whatever person, it happens quite regularly in my job now. That's still, I think, to the common person, a really probably the perk that they would think would be most exciting. And there's no doubt I still relish every conversation I have with these people who are the greatest ever to do it. But over the last quarter century of doing it, I think the thing that is the coolest is that we do things on a daily basis that people are going to remember for the rest of their lives. And it's literally just part of my normal. Yesterday, I had my cousin sent a couple friends this week. He was my cousin in Los Angeles, sent two friends who were here, said, "Hey, can you say hi to them?" They came in. I gave them a yearbook and a pin. I showed them a few Dodgers artifacts, and they were like beside themselves with like my 2:30 appointment is something they will be talking about for the rest of their lives. That's crazy. It's just, and it's been that way at the Dodgers, at the Diamondbacks, that you can give a ball to a kid and they're going to remember it, or introduce them to their favorite player, or just the impact you have because of what this game means and what the brand, the Hall of Fame means to people, is just probably the coolest perk when you can have that sort of impact every single day.
So with the Baseball Hall of Fame being one of the few, you know, pro sports where you guys have a Hall of Fame ceremony every year and, you know, different players get inducted, what's that experience like for you in your position now, like having that this past summer?
Well, so I actually started about 2 weeks before it. So really this year I was kind of shadowing Jeff Idelson, my predecessor, and kind of learning a lot of what they did. Two things that I'd say jump out at me. One, I mean, you can't even put into words how crazy it is to have like your baseball card collection. Literally, I'm sitting on the stage with Ted Simmons next to me on one side, Larry Walker on the other, Commissioner, Derek Jeter's a few feet away, Michael Jordan's in the crowd in front of me. My family is like a couple rows away from Michael Jordan. And I'm just like, I do not belong on this stage. It is crazy that I could be in that sort of position where I get to help this thing happen. But really, I'd say the biggest thing that blew me away in being a part of it was there is no events department at the Hall of Fame. It's basically every person, there's about 100 people, a little less than 100 people full time who work here, and people who have nothing to do with hospitality or entertainment or coordinating volunteers or making sure that the plaques get where they need to. Everybody just has a job, and this group of people come together. It's this well-oiled machine that takes a town of 2,000 people and can somehow manage to put together an event for 50, 60, 70,000 people. And it just goes off without a hitch. And it's because people just, they genuinely care about it. And so there's a woman who works in the mailroom during that weekend. She's helping run hospitality in the hotel for the players. And there's other people that just, I mean, everybody's got a job that's just, that transportation is done by the librarian. I mean, it just doesn't, none of it makes sense. And yet it all works. And it's really pretty cool. It's a really, really special thing to be a part of. And I can't wait until next year when I actually am part of the whole planning process and not just kind of come in on the back end.
So how long does it usually take to plan a Hall of Fame weekend or a Hall of Fame experience?
364 days. I mean, literally it ends. And then the next day you start. I mean, even literally to the point that you're looking at the stage and saying, okay, is there anything before we tear down the stage? Is there anything that we think we want to do differently for next year? And you immediately move into the planning for the next year. And it's not our only event. I mean, people joke. I have a friend who works at the Super Bowl and he's like, "Yeah, you and me, we each have one event. Haha." And it's like, we actually have a huge weekend in May that we have the Hall of Fame Classic. We bring back former players. We've got a year-round museum to operate that people think of the Hall of Fame as just the plaque gallery and all the debates about who belongs in and who doesn't. But there's a three-story museum here that is unbelievable with artifacts and conservation and all the things that go into any museum that you'd ever walk into. All of that stuff is a year-round endeavor, but the ceremony itself, I'd say we really start to ramp up. I mean, this time of year, we're definitely already focused on a lot of things for July. We've got this coming, I guess, 2 weeks from now. What day is today? Tuesday? Yeah, 2 weeks from today, I think the 25th. We'll be announcing if anybody got in from the Baseball Writers Association vote. And so I'll be on MLB Network and announcing that live. And again, that takes planning of having a whole live television show from our plaque gallery and a news conference for anybody that gets in and introductions and all those sorts of things. It's all part of the process.
Now, everyone kind of sees when players get inducted and that final ceremony, but people don't really see what happens after they're inducted. So I was kind of wondering, and I think a lot of other people do too, what are the relationships like after these players are inducted and keeping the relationships between them and the Hall of Fame as Hall of Famers?
It's a great question because it's a huge part of what we do. I mean, I'm I am regularly in touch with Hall of Famers. Almost every day I'm talking to somebody, and there are about two or three of us here. Myself, our VP of Communications and Education, and one of the woman who oversees, she's director of special events and transportation, things of that nature. One of the three of us is probably talking to a Hall of Famer almost every single day. What's pretty cool is you really do build, and I sensed this just from the first time I was there, you build a relationship with the whole family. And so you get to know the spouse of the Hall of Famer, their kids, and then ultimately their grandkids. I mean, Ted Simmons came with his whole family. And I mean, the reality is, unfortunately, somewhere down the road, Ted Simmons may not be here anymore, but I'll be able to get a chance to when his grandkids come back with their kids, I'll be able to say, you know what, I was there when your grandfather was inducted. And so we stay in touch with the families. We have year-round events, charitable events that we often ask them to attend. Well, we may send interviews their way. We do all sorts of things with them throughout the year that give us reason to stay in touch. And there's actually probably several who will pop in from time to time. Fergie Jenkins was here not that long ago for a charity event. Wade Boggs put together Burt Blyleven. They had random charitable things that they did that included, okay, a trip to Cooperstown with Wade Boggs. So Wade just randomly is in town, or Burt Blyleven came with a bunch of his college buddies. It just, people keep coming back here and we stay in touch with them for forever, Frank. And then we stay in touch with the family after they're gone as well.
That's amazing. Well, my final question for you is, what is a piece of advice you would give to AEPi brothers who aspire to work in the sports industry, whether it's in media, working for a team, working in the Baseball Hall of Fame? What would kind of be your advice to them?
It's really, I've always felt like the sports world, succeeding in the sports world, really comes down to three things. It's work ethic, it's passion, and it's creativity. And so you really can't succeed without all three. Work ethic kind of goes without saying, but this is not a 9-to-5 job. There are weeks where I was working 80 hours a week, and I was making way less money than my friends who came out of the business school at Indiana. But I loved what I did, and I just stuck with it. And obviously it's led me to this position where I make a very nice living, but ultimately you put in a lot of crazy hours, and your work ethic has to be off the charts in the sports world. It just, particularly baseball more than any other sport, because it's 162 games. I mean, it is relentless. And so I think work ethic is a big thing. Passion. You have to love what you're doing. The hours are way too long to do this and not truly love it. And if you don't love the game, it's going to chew you up, spit you out. And by the time you're 25, you're going to say, this isn't what I want to do for the rest of my life. And so you really have to have a passion for it. And then creativity. You kind of have to think outside the box a little bit. I mean, I say this all the time, but I'm never the smartest guy in any room that I'm ever in. I wasn't an Ivy League grad. I wasn't the smartest person that I, that's not how I've made it. I've made it based on thinking a little bit outside the box, being creative, not easily taking no for an answer, really just trying to think differently. And that's, I think, if I could give advice to anybody that wanted to get into sports, it would be work your butt off, have a true passion for what you're doing, and try to think outside the box, and don't just kind of do what you've always done, because otherwise you just keep repeating the same exact thing.
Great.
Beautiful. Sammy, thank you so much for the thoughtful questions and kicking us off here. We wanted to give the audience here an opportunity to also ask questions. We left out some of the hard-hitting ones, so I'll let you all do that.
It's all good. So whatever you got, I'm fine.
If you do have a question and you want to either hit the raise hand reaction button or just put your hand up, I'll start by calling on Past Supreme Master Philip H. Cohen. And Phil, I just hit the ask to unmute, so if you're able to hit that, there you go.
Okay. I'm an old Brooklyn Dodger fan. I was at the 25th anniversary at Shea Stadium, and I know how it must feel to you to be around all those players. Well, I was with the Boys of Summer in the box office, in the dugout, because my father-in-law was Irving Rudd, who was the press and road secretary of the Brooklyn Dodgers during the heyday of it.
That's awesome.
So my question is, do you have an original Brooklyn Dodger World Series ring and or the Brooklyn Dodger World Championship bat signed by all the players. I'm curious because I have one.
That's awesome. I'd have to find out for you on a bat signed by all the players. Interestingly, autograph memorabilia is not something that we focus a lot of our collections on. Our collections tend to focus more on the stories. And so it's a game used bat for this home run or this pitch or this play, whatever. It's not that we don't collect autographs. That's not where we put a lot of our attention. We do have a World Series ring for sure. We've got rings going back to every ring that was ever made. On the display on the third floor, we have one of our exhibits is called Autumn Glory, and it focuses on the World Series, and it changes over every year. So right now it's actually got all the Brave stuff that we brought back with us from the World Series. But there's a case that actually has all of the World Series rings going back to literally when they started making them. And even before that, they made pins. In the earliest days of the World Series, before they actually gave away rings, they gave away other things. This exhibit has all of those things in there. So
1955 rings, at least I can, other rings may have also had it, has the name of the player and the very few in the 1950s, only the team, the couple of owners, because there weren't many owners, and the trainer, the manager. My father-in-law has one with his name on it.
It's so cool.
So I'm wondering, the 55 is, you know, they're one of a kind and they're extremely, extremely valuable. If you have the 55 year ring.
I would have to go look and tell you where it came from. But the incredible thing about this place is people donate all the time. And so when we're done, I'm going to go upstairs. I'll track down who it is. I'll go look and see whose name is on it and send it to Alec to share with you. But
I'd be very curious.
Yeah. And I'm actually looking on my wall right to my right is my farewell gift from the Dodgers when I left was a photo of Sandy Koufax in his first big league win with Roy Campanella, Jackie Robinson, and Gil Hodges. And they're all now four Hall of Famers.
The Brooklyn Dodgers.
Exactly.
Yeah. Most Brooklyn Dodger fans did not become Los Angeles Dodger fans. As a matter of fact, Walter O'Malley, you may have heard, was burned in effigy all over Brooklyn.
Oh, I know. My father-in-law was a Brooklyn Dodger fan, and when he swore off baseball for a very long time until I married his daughter, and then he kind of had to become a Dodger fan again. So thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Phil. I'm going to call on Roger Tyrone next. Roger, you should be able to unmute now.
Hey, Josh, this has been like super cool listening to you. Wanted to give you just a couple of real quick things I put into the chat. Talk about Brooklyn Dodger fans. My mom grew up, was best friends with Pat O'Malley, and in 1949, went to the annual Dodger dinner. Phil, you're going to enjoy seeing this because my mom took the program around and got like 22 autographs from walking around dinner. It's got some original food stains on the program, all that good stuff. So you talk about the Dodgers, huge history there. And it's just awesome that we still have this for the family and stuff like that. And she's still a fan and 89 years old. Second thing is 2010, I take my son. We went to the Marlin game at season tickets. My son sits 10 seats behind home plate, watches Roy Halladay pitch a perfect game against the Marlins. And him and his other, you know, moron kid friend don't quite understand what they're watching, you know. And but I explain it to them. They get the concept. You know, he's, 10 years old or whatever at the time. So a few months later, we're going up fishing in the Adirondacks. We go up early. We go to induction weekend. That was a year. Andre Dawson, the Hawk, comes into the hall. It's just awesome. So you have that hall where you've got the no-hitters and the perfect game plaques and these little tiny little plaques, right? So I take my son, we're walking around, we're having a great immersive experience, which is really the comment here is the hall is the immersion. It's the visual and the sound and everything that just envelops you when you get, even when you're driving into to town and past the field and all this stuff. So I take him in and I say, listen, look at this. in the history of baseball, these are all the no-hitters. And look, son, see these plaques? These are the perfect games. And I think Halliday was like the 20th or whatever it was. And there were a couple that remember that. So that's when it clicked in this little kid's brain, what he witnessed, you know. And that's a great thing about the hall. I just wanted to comment. It is just, it's an awesome thing about going in the, going up there. And I went as a kid, and my parents took me up there. And when I took my son, I'm going to tell you, I'm talking about it 13 years later, and it's still choking me up. So that's all I wanted to say. Thanks for coming on this really, really, I don't know why there aren't 500 people on this call, honestly.
Well, no worries. It's hearing your passion. Yeah. I mean, that's hearing you talk is why this, every single person on this call has stories like that, that whether it's, I mean, that's one of the things we do. We connect generations. And so it's going with your parents, going with your kids and the memories. And you can just, everybody can talk about that game that they remember and then what it did to them. It's pretty awesome. So thank you for sharing that.
Thank you, Roger. I'll go in order here. We've got John and then Scott. So John, you should be able to unmute here.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah.
All right, perfect. First off, I love the Baseball Hall of Fame. I put on my Hall of Fame member pin.
Nice, thank you.
Wanted to say, first off, for everybody on here, Hall of Fame right now, great COVID safe activity. I've gone a couple times, drove from New Hampshire, love Cooperstown, also a Red Sox season ticket holder. But I wanted to say, so I was actually, I've been listening to sports radio all day today. And one of the, what I want to say, there's a lot of talk about Hall of Fame voting and how it's basically become where you have a lot of the younger voting, they're all public about it, but you have a lot of older voters who either won't release their ballot, or if they do, basically they're trolling. It feels like where, obviously, I mean, Boston Sports Radio, Dan Shaughnessy has been the talk today where he voted for Jeff Kent. And I think that hurts the Hall of Fame's value when you have these older voters almost with protest or trolling votes. And what can be done about that? Because for a lot, for hearing all day, it's all younger people calling in and they're all like, this is a joke. And do you think that hurts the Hall of Fame with that? And also can't wait to be there this summer to hopefully see David Ortiz inducted. I'm very excited.
That's awesome. Well, thank you, John. Thank you for being a member. For those of you that don't know, we have membership programs. And so it comes with all sorts of cool benefits. You can certainly jump in there and be like John. But a few things. I mean, I don't, everybody's got their own perspective. And honestly, I saw somebody put in the chat, like, Jeff Kent is a joke vote. Like, I worked with him closely at the Dodgers. I actually covered him for a year at the Giants. He's got more home runs as a second baseman than anybody that's ever done it before. So I don't know. I think what surprises me is how many people believe that the writers that have votes don't take it incredibly seriously. And you can disagree all you want with what somebody's opinion is, but someone who's covered the sport for 10 years. I mean, there's actually another really good article today out by a guy named Dan Connolly on The Athletic. He's a Baltimore writer. And he basically said, like, every year I put out my vote and I just get lambasted for it. And people think I'm an idiot. And the thing I just don't understand is, does anybody really think that any writer would give their life to dedicating a sport and then not take seriously the voting part? Like, even if you disagree with what they're doing, I guess the short answer is we've constantly changed the process over the years. We look for ways to make sure it gets better. One of the ways we've done that is that for those that aren't aware, when you've covered baseball for 10 years as part of the Baseball Writers Association, you get a ability to vote. And so then you get your ballot every year in December, and then you have to file it, or end of November, you have to file it by the end of December. And for the most part, people who, let's say you're in your 20s or 30s when you start covering, you're getting a vote all throughout your 40s, 50s, 60s. But let's say you retire. Once you've stopped covering baseball in any sort of meaningful way for a decade, we actually no longer allow you to vote, because if you basically aren't covering the sport anymore and aren't keeping up with it, we want to make sure that we don't just have hundreds of people who don't still follow the sport. So, I mean, the short answer is, yeah, we're always listening for ways to potentially make it better, but When I got this job, the former librarian of the Hall of Fame, a guy named Jim Gates, sent me an article from 1939 in the New York Times. It was the first class that had ever gotten voted in, five guys. And it was this whole story in the New York Times about how these voters don't know what the hell they're doing and how come they can't get this right. And it's like, people have been arguing about the voting process for literally as long as we've existed, from the very first day we opened. So we try to get it right. We certainly don't want to have people, if we felt like somebody was truly using their vote as a joke, like I'm going to pick eight guys who really, and they can't, then maybe we'd have to address it. But I really don't think we don't see voters who don't take this seriously. We just don't. They take it seriously. They just may have a different opinion than you do or someone else does of what constitutes a Hall of Famer.
Beautiful. Scott, I'm going to ask you to unmute here.
Cool. Thank you, Alec and Zach and who's the guy who was interviewing, Sammy, I think, and Josh, thank you for being here. Thank everybody at HQ for putting this together. I'm wearing my White Sox hat. It's what I use to play basketball. It's the break from work in the morning out here in sunny LA, back in the hometown. But the Dodgers hat just doesn't work as well for basketball. So, but tried and true, and dad from the South Side too. So nice. Like you're talking about that generational passing down of baseball and all that, even though I'm a basketball guy, but different generation, I guess. Playing at least, watching always baseball too. You were talking earlier about, in your trio of like great advice, one thing you talk about is passion. And I think some of the jobs that I've had, or probably a lot of people on the call, where we've been very passionate at our work, has been a lot because of the team we were working with or the colleagues we had. And so I was wondering if you had any great experiences or insights, or as you kind of went on a trajectory in the sports industry, where it was either learning moments or like just great experiences and insights that you gained as far as building kind of almost like that work pledge class, because you spoke about, you know, yeah, we have these wonderful memories coming into the work world, and then going forward, it's like kind of almost get an opportunity to rebuild pledge classes at every stop you make, you know?
That's an interesting way to look at it. But certainly my work pledge class, interestingly, there are three of my best friends in the world are people that I interned with at the Dodgers or worked with right out of school. And I think in some ways, when you get older, you'll make mistakes in judgment. You may make a decision that isn't the same. I mean, that happened. I'd say any of us learn from the decisions we make that don't work out. But I feel like when you're younger, you may be making mistakes that you don't even know how to think about it. You're just kind of going about it and you do something. And so I feel like coming up with that group in the 20s, and three of my best friends in the world, we actually, every offseason from probably, I don't even know, 99 to 05, the four of us would pick a place on the map and go travel somewhere abroad during the offseason. We built these incredible friendships because you're working together so much, but you're also screwing up a lot together. I can remember, actually, this may speak to what you're saying, but it actually kind of in a way speaks to what I was saying about passion, work ethic, and this pledge class kind of idea. There was a probably late 90s, maybe 99, maybe 98. The Dodgers had a giveaway item that was just a typical hat night at the ballpark. And somebody about the 2 days before we were about to do it, the shipment shows up, somebody opens up one of the boxes and is like, this isn't the right color blue. Like these are a little bit, have like a purplish tint to them. And somebody opened up another box and they're like, well, these look fine. And so it ultimately became like, we got to figure out which of these are purple and which of these are blue and not give out the purple ones. Well, there's 60,000 of these things. And myself and one of my buddies, Brian, basically got in our suit. We were in our suits and we climbed into these trailers in the dead summer of Los Angeles. And it's hot and we're literally in shirts and ties. We're climbing through boxes and boxes to find these, which hats were blue, and make sure that we don't give away the purple ones. And it was a passion for what we were doing. It was a work ethic that we weren't afraid to. I mean, you just, nothing was certainly going to be below us. We wanted to make sure we got it right. And it bonded me and him to the point that we still talk about it 30 years, like 25, 30 years later. So, I mean, I think there's been any number of mistakes I've made. I certainly, for those of you that are familiar with Frank and Jamie McCourt, the owner of the Dodgers, who got divorced, and I lived through everything that went on during that era. And there are things that I look at that maybe I could have done differently, certainly things that I wish we had done differently as an organization. And I often think about how in some ways how lucky I was that in my late 20s into my late 30s or mid 30s, I got this chance to be a part of that, where there was plenty of success, but there was plenty of screw ups. And you learn so much. I guess the biggest thing is you never want to stop learning. And literally, I told you guys earlier about the presentation I did yesterday for the whole Hall of Fame staff. First thing I did this morning was we had a meeting and I asked the senior staff, what didn't I get right? How can I deliver it better? Is there a way that we can resonate better with the staff? And I took a bunch of pieces of feedback that we'll use in the future. So, I mean, you're certainly, even as the president of the Hall of Fame, I'm going to continue to make mistakes. You got to kind of believe in what you're doing and just stay with it. And cool that you're a Sox and Dodgers fan, because I was there when we opened up Camelback Ranch back in 08. I got to be a part of the group that opened up the spring training site for both of them. And they'll always be connected by that in 1959. So thanks, Scott.
Amazing. And George Weiss would like to know, did those purple hats become collector's items?
I think we got rid of them. I mean, it's funny you say that, because I know a lot of people do then ask, you know, what do you do with these things when you find the mistakes? That's not the only mistake items that you've seen over the years, but I think we purposefully threw them out or had them recycled so that they couldn't show up anywhere. I'm pretty sure we didn't want that appearing elsewhere.
Amazing. Just because I want to be mindful of time here, I know our very own Zach Kirshner has a question, so I want to give him the opportunity, and then we'll let everyone go on with the rest of their day.
So growing up, Josh, I mean, I was young, but a lot of the players that like Sammy Sosa, Mark McGwire, people that are coming up on their last year of the ballot right now, and then also you have the inevitable Pete Rose question. I was curious what your thoughts are on that, and in addition to those on the ballot that might be tied to like the steroid era, et cetera.
You know, in a lot of ways, it goes back to the question that was asked a little bit ago, just about voting and. I mean, ultimately, what we feel our job is really to honor those who are elected by the baseball writers and ultimately by the era committees. So, I mean, we do have a very clear clause and have since the very beginning of the Hall of Fame that character does matter. And so ultimately, we're careful not to tell the voters what does that mean. Some people think we ought to give them greater clarity as to, well, what is character, does character... How can you not let in this person who might have done steroids, but if you don't let them in, but you do let in somebody who used a spitball or somebody who did something else in the 60s or 50s when it was. And the reality is we don't see it as our job to adjudicate that. We ultimately have an electorate of hundreds of people. And if 75% of them agree that someone belongs in the Hall of Fame, that's how they get in. And we see it as our job to then honor that person. And you try to tell the history. There are, I think, I can't remember who made the comment. Might've been John, I think, who made the comment about the museum and how wonderful this place is. And Roger's talking about all the sights and sounds, but the museum is filled with incredible stories about Sammy Sosa and Mark McGwire and Pete Rose and anybody else who may not have a plaque on the wall. The history is still the history of the game, and you can absolutely still go see it. It doesn't mean, again, they still have to somehow get elected by the 75% of the voters, either the writers or and that's where, to the question about the writers, sometimes if you did somehow have a problem where the writers were purposely not electing somebody and it was such a problem, which I don't think would ever happen. I really don't. But we have a secondary process where the era committees allow you to bring in executives, historians, and actual Hall of Famers who are enshrined in the plaque gallery to help. There's 16 of them that will look. And if you can get 12 of those 16, 75% to vote for, you have a second shot. So we think the kind of checks and balances works. Is there a perfect system? I don't know, but somebody here asked about my personal opinion on Clemens and Bonds specifically, or am I supposed to avoid that answer? I to be totally honest, I don't have personal opinions. I mean, what I love is that you can, no matter who you grew up rooting for, you can come to this museum and see them all over the place. And it's not my place to say whether they deserve a plaque on the wall. But I think we'd be doing something really wrong if they didn't have a place in the museum, for sure. I mean, you can't, you can't have seasons and you can't tell the story of the 90s without those players, 90s and 2000s. And so I think it's important that we continue to cover everybody from Shoeless Joe Jackson through anybody else who, for whatever reason or another, doesn't have a plaque. The history is still the history, and we won't change that. Our job is to preserve it.
Thank you.
I still have time for a couple more. If anybody else has anything else you want to ask, happy to answer.
I just want to say, like, the Hall of Fame truly is sacred ground, just like everyone's saying. And I got to say thank you, everyone, like, for joining us. And big thank you to Josh. Big thank you to Josh. This has been amazing.
Hopefully some of you will come visit us out here. And if you have, it's funny how many people tell me this is on their bucket list. And it's like, our job is to get this from the bucket list to the to-do list and put it on the calendar. I mean, there's so much cool stuff. Maybe not right now when it's negative. I'm looking outside the window. There's snow everywhere and it's -2, but even now there's some beauty to the fact that in the museum there might be 15 people. You have the whole place to yourself if you walk in there right now. There's everything from the lake to the other museums in town and Main Street and shopping, and the golf course is incredible. There's just so much cool stuff to do here. I hope if you haven't been, you'll take a chance. If you cared enough to sit here and listen to me ramble for an hour, you would be far more impressed by spending time and energy coming out to Cooperstown and checking it out.
Well, thank you so much, Josh. It looks like we've got one more question here from our executive director, Jay Feldman, who is joining us. Zach, are you able to unmute him? Oh, all right, Jay, you're on.
Thank you, Alec. Really appreciate it. Josh, again, just to echo everyone, thank you so much for joining us. We really, truly, truly appreciate it. This has been exciting. To Roger's point about there should be 500 people on here, we heard from so many brothers where the time conflicted. That's why we're recording it. And hopefully we'll plan maybe an AEPi alumni visit to Cooperstown and bring everybody there together. So that would be a lot of fun, of course. A question that I have is, I'm sure it's not unique to the Jewish community in America as one of the primary immigrant groups, but certainly within the Jewish community, baseball is as sacred as the Torah for some. I just wonder your thoughts are on why you think that is. And even as it continues on with our students and future generations, just if you have any thoughts on that.
Oh man, that's a heavy question, but I guess in a way, I think history plays a huge part in both baseball and religion. Connecting generations plays a big part in baseball and religion. A lot of us may be Jewish because our parents raised us to be Jewish, as opposed to choosing the religion yourself. And it's something for me, as somebody who's really kind of in touch with the cultural side of the religion, I love the fact that I can think about generations before me that had a bar mitzvah and people. It's weird to make this connection, but I love the fact that my dad and my son both listen to Vin Scully call games and that they both went to the same ballparks. And that, so there's a level of like the connection going back in time that I think is, and of course, passion. I mean, people are so passionate about sports. Obviously for all of us, it may be baseball, but for plenty of others, Scott was mentioning basketball or people that love the people yesterday or Sunday for the last game of the NFL. I mean, the country was entirely focused on a pigskin being flung around a 100-yard field. It doesn't even make any sense when you think about the history of mankind, why that would matter so much, and yet it does. So I think somebody, Zach just mentioned, he's got Jolton Joe DiMaggio song stuck in his head from his visit. I mean, these little things that we remember, I remember sneaking out of high holiday services to go run around downstairs. And I'll leave you with this because it's actually kind of a fun way to close it out like that. Right after the Braves won the World Series, some of you may know that Max Fried, their Braves pitcher, is Jewish. And there's an Astros player, Alex Bregman, who's Jewish. So when they faced each other in game one of the World Series this year, game three, I think, one of the early games of the World Series, they believed it was the first time the two Jews had faced off in the World Series, which was just an incredibly cool moment to think about, kind of hard to believe, but also very true. And so the game, Max Fried actually grew up His high school coach was my teammate in high school. This weird connection to him. So after we're down on the field and somebody we both knew was down there, and the next thing you know, we wind up having this random discussion about Judaism on the field after they've won the World Series in Houston. And I just thought, like, immediately Max and I had a connection. We'd never met. We both knew the same people, and our religion kind of connected us in a way that I probably a lot of whether races, genders, things that just you immediately feel a common bond with somebody. So I guess in a way that's probably why I wound up joining AEPi in the first place, was feeling that common bond with others when I was far away from home in Indiana. And I appreciate everybody giving me time today to chat about the Hall of Fame and catch up with all of you.
Absolutely. Josh and Sammy, thank you so much for your time today. If you enjoyed this webinar, you could join us next month with Leon Cooperman, Chairman of Omega Advisors, by visiting AEPi.org/Zoom-registration. The link is in the chat and will be emailed as a follow-up. Thank you again, everyone, for being with us today. We look forward to seeing you all at the next AEPiConnect 11 Leadership Speaker Series. Have a great rest of your day.